Okay, let us continue. So we discussed this representation for the density of complex eigenvalues, and I mentioned that there is a similar formula for the density of real eigenvalues of this elliptic ensemble. And now, why it's called elliptic? If one considers, it's slightly more involved, but not really much more involved, using this integral representation of Hermite polynomials, substituted here, we can find asymptotic expression for the kernel, and eventually then using large argument behavior of Erfic function to find the density of complex and real eigenvalues. And basically, it turns out that the density in the large n limit, basically eigenvalues fill in the interior of an ellipse, and this is the name, this gives the name to the ensemble of the semicircle, oh sorry, of the semi-axis of the longer semi-axis along X with the right end position 1 plus tau square root of n. And this point, the semi-axis along y direction, is at 1 minus tau square root of n. Of course, when tau equals to 0, we are back to the circle of radius square root of n, as we know for Gnieber. So this is generalization. Also, in the limit tau approaching 1, this vertical direction shrinks, and all eigenvalues eventually become real when tau is equal to 1. Otherwise, there is a gradual process of transforming this. So one can guess that when 1 minus tau becomes of the order of 1 over square root of n, there is non-trivial crossover regime, but I'm not going to discuss it now. And one also can find that the density of real eigenvalues, it's uniform and depends on tau, but uniform here. And the for any fixed tau not equal to 1, the number of real eigenvalues is of order of square root of n, whereas the number of complex eigenvalues is of order n. Okay, so what about other properties that we learned in the previous lectures about Gnieber ensemble eigenvalues? All of them have their straightforward analogs. For example, the large deviation result if one scales, which is natural, to scale these matrices x by square root of n, by x divided by square root of n, then the density converges to equilibrium measure when n tends to infinity. One should just suppress then the square root of n. There will be an ellipse with semi-axis of order of 1. We always, from now on, will consider this rescaling done in order to have well-defined limits. And for example, large deviation result is practically of the same form. So probability that the measure, counting measure, whose density is empirical density, to belong to some to subset set B is exactly of the same form with rate n square, and then we should minimize some functional J of mu
Which can be found in the lecture notes. I won't write it. It's quite similar with some modifications, including this new parameter tau, but it's quite similar in its properties to the corresponding functional for Ginibre ensemble. Basically, the same properties, that it has unique minimizer, and this minimizer is the equilibrium density, this elliptical equilibrium density. What about probability? So of probability that the eigenvalue with the largest real part exceeds value x, which is now larger than 1 plus tau. So what is this right end probability to be found somewhere here to the right of this equilibrium density h? The formula has the same type as, of course, for Ginibre, but just I'd like to present explicitly this right. This large deviation functional, it generalizes a known result for Gaussian orthogonal ensemble and for Ginibre, so gives true interpolation between them, so generalizes known result in the literature. Does not seem to be available in the literature, so I, in fact, just worked it out. Preparing these lectures. But the method is just generalization. I mean, just basically the same method that works for Ginibre, just slightly more complicated. So this is explicit form of the functional. Satya showed us, I think, this expression for tau equal 1. He mentioned UE, but I mean, it's not that much important. It's practically the same. Functional. So for tau equal 1, it goes to known large deviation function first found by Benarus, Demba, and Guianin, then rediscovered by Satya. This is right deviation function. Okay, properties are natural at the edge. For x larger than 1 plus tau, this is positive function. For at the edge, it's zero, as expected. And now, let us rewrite in terms. So now we understand that we should express everything in terms of this matrices X, or rather in terms of this rescaled ensemble. So when I rescale, I'll call it new matrix Z. And what are the formulas that we'd like to evaluate? So this is mean value of this counting of the number of equilibria. I put here index sigma, just which will take two values, just to write it. Just one formula. One value is I will call sigma takes two values. One is EQ, which means equilibria. It means total number of equilibria. And I will use another index ST for stable equilibria. So what is this in terms expected value of this in terms of parameters of our problem and properties of this ensemble? So it's 1 divided by m to n. This m to n, if you remember in the formula that I showed to you, was factor 1 over mu to n, but now I use the May parameter, they are not any longer here, so I will probably reintroduce it. So May parameter is mu divided by its characteristic value given in terms of variances of gradient and non-gradient part of the field. So 1 m to power n.
and then integral over the real axis, then exponential minus n x minus m squared divided by 2 tau. Then d n sigma of x dx over square root of 2 pi divided by n. And where dn's are these expected values of the modulus of characteristic polynomial of this Jacobian matrix, namely dn equilibrium is just expected value of determinant of x, x delta ij, I will write, minus zij, where z is this rescaled elliptic ensemble, rescaled to have equilibrium density in interval of order of unity, over z. And similarly, not surprisingly, dn stable is the same, basically the same determinant, but just condition chi k of z, where chi is indicator function, which is one if all real part of eigenvalues smaller than x, so that's why it bears index x, and zero otherwise. So, just a few words how this, we remember that it was just expectation of ensemble of Jacobian matrices, and there was no integral. So how this integral appeared? This integral is just basically rescaled integral, just averaging over this normal variable psi. Since z is basically rescaled x, so we still need to take into account that our Jacobian matrix, ensemble of Jacobian matrices, contains this extra single variable, and this is precisely what this Gaussian integral. It's just that variable in after shift and disguise. Okay, so how to evaluate these expectations of determinant? The first thing which I just like to mention, that in fact the first of these determinant can be evaluated exactly. Exactly for any n. Exactly any n. Any size of the matrix. This is just a fortunate observation. I won't go this route, although I maybe mention some results which one obtains in this way later on if I have time. But why it's possible to evaluate? If you remember, in my lecture yesterday, I discussed the relation between the density of complex eigenvalues and basically expected value of squared determinant, basically, of Ginibre ensemble. This was obtained by employing incomplete Schur decomposition, assuming that the matrix has complex eigenvalues. Now, complex eigenvalue, and then you calculate density of this eigenvalue. Now, absolutely the same trick can be done assuming that the matrix has one real eigenvalue, and then finding density of this real eigenvalue, and it turns out that basically a formula for the density of real eigenvalues is simply proportional to exactly to this object.
It's just okay for the for ensemble with reduced size by one. This time by one. In complex it's by two. Here it's by one. It's clear from this block structure. So since there are explicit formulas due to Forrester and Nagao for the whole, I just forgot to mention that first these formulas were worked out by in the very nice work by Forrester and Nagao, just extending their work, earlier work on Ginibre ensemble. So these formulas are explicitly given. It amount, therefore, one can calculate just this basically by analyzing asymptotics of this kernel and in all regimes that we need. And this can be, asymptotics can be done, but also, I mean, for finite n, just explicit result. So mean number of equilibria can be found, in fact, in this model for any n. This is, we will see when this is helpful, but I'd like today, but this method obviously won't, or at least, I won't say obviously, this method is not obvious how to apply to evaluate the number of stable equilibria. Similar problem for purely gradient, flow, for tau equal one, number of stable equilibria in that situation, which are basically minima, counting minima of this Lyapunov functional, which drives gradient dynamics. This can be done also exactly, because there is a mapping of this condition determinant in that case, only in that case, one can find a mapping to the problem of the largest eigenvalue, exactly to the largest eigenvalue of GOE. I'm not aware, and I tried, the fact that I failed does not mean that more clever people won't find such a relation, but so far I was not able to find any trick which would help me to evaluate this condition determinant. And in our first paper with Boris Korozhenko, we just left this as an interesting problem, but later on, joining forces with Gerard Benarous, basically we realized that large deviation theory gives gives a nice way, and simple way, in fact, of extracting asymptotic, large in n, most interesting behavior of this, but still not for finite n. So let me proceed describing this this root via large deviations. And in order to do this, let me... there was a lot of discussion of large deviations in Silvia Serfati series of lectures, but I think, maybe I'm wrong, but I think that she did not mention one fundamental fact about large deviations, which is important here, and this is really what is known as Laplace-Varadan theorem. I think she did not make any use of this, or maybe implicitly, and therefore did not mention it. So what is this statement about? So let me remind you that, say, a random variable X has large deviation, satisfies large deviation principle if probability, okay, it's indexed by, say, some parameter n, which is eventually tends to infinity, and we are interested in this probability of X belonging to some set. And informally, if this behavior is exponential with a rate which I call alpha n, for example, for random matrices that we discussed, it was for the left alpha n was n squared, for the right it was n, so it just speed. I don't know what is the function is called rate function, but this is this called speed? Maybe someone tells me what is correct name for this parameter which governs really the order of magnitude of this probability, and then we have some rate function. And now Laplace-Varadam theorem basically discusses the following. Consider a function f of variable x, which is we will consider to be bounded function,
And then consider the object which is natural to call, it's a functional of f, which is natural to call partition function. And frequently it has the meaning of partition function, but not always. But it's basically just this type of integral. So it's basically we are averaging exponential of this function f of x with some different speed, or in general different speed. It may coincide with alpha, but maybe also smaller or larger than alpha, so different speed. And we are interested in basically behavior of this as n tends to infinity. And the statement is that if alpha, so this behaves asymptotically as exponential minus alpha n, then one should minimize infimum over of f plus I, where I is this rate functional for the probability of large deviations. This is the case when alpha n and alpha are of the same order. Asymptotically, they are the same. And it's especially easy to understand when this Pn has a density which behaves then necessarily exponentially, then this is just Laplace evaluation of this integral. That's why it's called Laplace. But Varadhan extended it to much broader class. For example, it's x can be not just simple relative variable, but random measure and even more complicated object, measures on measures. So it's really extension of this to, physicists would call to functional integrals. But basically this is what it is. And also, suppose now a second case is when alpha n tilde is smaller than, is subleading, growing to infinity slower than alpha n. Then, in this case, obviously what happens, that the integral will be dominated, then the result is then just exponential of minus alpha n tilde f at, I will write it x star, where x star is just minimizer of this I. It's obvious also because then alpha n tilde, if it grows not as fast as alpha n, then the integral will be dominated basically by minimum of the rate function. And you just substitute it there, and this is the leading behavior. So I will need this. Okay, Laplace-Varadhan theorem is more general statement, but this is what I need from it. And why this is really the helpful bit, which helps to evaluate these dn's. Okay, it's very simple. Now I need to get rid of this. What is written here? So basically, the idea is to represent this determinant in the form when we can apply basically this Laplace-Varadhan evaluation. So how it's done? And simply, so if we introduce again this empirical measure, which is sum of delta functions of standard eigenvalues of our matrix, and consider the corresponding measure for which this is density as mu n, then one can just literally rewrite dn equilibrium. We start with dn equilibrium. This is just then exponential. So what I do, I simply write instead of mod that, I just exponentiate it. I write it exponential of log of mod that, and then basically it's immediately clear that I can rewrite it in the following way. Phi x of mu
where phi x of mu is just what sometimes is called logarithmic potential for the measure. Logarithm of x minus z d mu z, d mu n z, right? This is just rewriting, exponentiating, taking log and then rewriting it. But now let us start with equilibrium, and then we will see in the end how to deal with number of stable points. So we see that this integral basically is a variant of this type of expression, where expectation is with the law of the measure, of the counting measure. And for this measure, we know that this corresponding speed is n squared. So we are here in second situation. We are here. So we immediately can conclude that asymptotically, this will be nothing else. So asymptotically, applying Laplace-Varadin. Okay, there is immediately you can, you should tell me, you are cheating, and I'm cheating, because I mentioned that Laplace-Varadin is, at least as I stated it, is valid for bounded function. Here we deal with log, which is potentially unbounded. But fortunately, people who are in this business of large deviations and special invariant masses, they know how to tame this behavior of log at large and small arguments where it's potentially dangerous. So virtually, this is a bounded function. Or at least one can show that this unboundedness does not produce any problem. So I will pretend that it's you can apply straightforwardly this Laplace Varadin. And then you just should conclude that leading term is just n phi of x, where phi of x is phi x of mu equilibrium. Phi x of mu equilibrium, and then it can be calculated if you take this equilibrium density inside ellipse, you can integrate it with log, useful exercise, and one gets that phi of x is equal to, okay, I will write it explicitly, expression maybe not that nice, but still, you can work with it. In some sense, it's nice. It's not short, but it's nice. You can work with it quite efficiently. Okay. Log divided by 2. For x smaller than 1 plus tau. So this happens when a parameter x is on the x is real, is inside this support of the equilibrium measure. When it's outside, the support of equilibrium measure, and inside it's very simple. In fact, Silvia mentioned that it's always inside equilibrium measure. It's basically quadratic, so it's quadratic. Okay, it's just quadratic polynomial in x with trivial coefficients. I won't write it explicitly. Maybe I'll write it when I use it. Okay, so if this is correct, we can proceed. And so remaining job is to perform this now this integral, but this is relatively straightforward. Let us do it. So we need to I will write this n equilibrium equal to 1 over m to n integral
over all r exponential minus n, I just deliberately write it, L equilibrium of x, where L is obtained by adding up phi of x and this bit here, dx, and L is just x minus m squared divided by 2 tau minus phi of x.
Okay, so how to evaluate asymptotics of this integral? Obviously, one should look for, applying Laplace method to it, but one should do it accurately. Really, there are, because of different behavior at x larger than 1 plus tau and x smaller than 1 plus tau, one needs to subdivide real x's into three regimes or three intervals, 1 plus tau, minus 1 plus tau. So this for internal part to use one expression, and here outside to use a different expression for phi, and then proceed evaluating it. So it turns out that let me write down, consider first part, I will call it A. A, part A, so this this integral, there L is given by, now you will see what is phi inside the support, because I can write it here. This quadratic piece which I mentioned, 2 over 1 plus tau plus 1 half. So nice quadratic expression. One finds that differentiating and setting to 0, one finds that there is a stationary point x, which is a stationary point of this L, where derivative vanishes, equal to m times 1 plus tau. So in order to dominate integral inside A, one should ensure that m is smaller than 1. So if m is larger than 1, this is outside the domain of integration. So integral will be dominated by the right end, one can show by the right end. Otherwise, for m smaller than 1, it will be dominated by this saddle point, well, not saddle point, minimum. And calculating everything, one gets expression for Na. Okay, I will call it average N, contribution A, contribution from part A, which is different for smaller or larger than, M smaller or larger than 1. And this is, expression is exponential minus N. Here is m squared minus 1 over 2 plus log m